In chapter 15, verse 13, by way of reminder, we came to the end of the doctrinal section of the book of Romans. I want to back up one verse, verse 13. It's a marvelous benediction, and I'm being slightly tempted to preach on this in a couple of weeks here at Revival on Sunday morning. I want you to look at verse 13. Paul said, "Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit." What a beautiful closing benediction. Now, in this closing benediction, Paul comes to the end of the doctrinal section, the end of the teaching or didactic section of the book of Romans. The remainder of the letter forms what might be called an epilogue. It's kind of just a capsulizing or a conclusion where he tells several things. He tells them why he wrote the letter to them. He tells them about his ministry among them and his heart and his mission that God has given unto him. Now, let me just give you, and I honestly, I can't get bogged down in this, and we had it on the screen. I don't know if we still have it or ready to show it, but not just listen carefully. There are four main sections of the book of Romans that we've covered. After the brief introduction in chapter 1, verses 1 to 17, the first main division was condemnation. The wrath of God was revealed, chapter 1, verse 18, all the way through to chapter 3 and verse 20. And in that section, Paul's dealing with the question of how the world is lost and guilty before God. And we saw the heathen condemned, we saw the moral man condemned, we saw the Jew or the religious man condemned, and then he showed us the whole world is guilty and in need of the gospel before God. The second main division is called salvation, or I've given it that title, salvation, the righteousness of God revealed. And it runs from chapter 3, verse 21, to chapter 8, verse 39. How does God save sinners? So here's the logical flow. First you have condemnation, then you have salvation. The idea is you need to see your need of the gospel. Paul is presenting the gospel in the book of Romans, and before we're going to want to understand the gospel, we need to see that there's a need for the gospel. And the need for the gospel is that everyone has sinned and that everyone has fallen short of the glory of God. There's no one righteous, no, not one. Don't you think the world needs the gospel today? I believe that that's the number one thing the world needs today. It needs the gospel. Doesn't need just kind of education, doesn't need clothes and food. It needs those things, but the primary thing the world needs, it needs the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what this text this evening is about, Paul being called to preach that gospel, and that's what our calling is, to get the good news out. So first the bad news, condemnation, then the good news. And under that division, we saw that God saves sinners in Christ Jesus. We looked at justification, sanctification, and preservation. And then the third main division is called vindication, chapters 9, 10, and 11, the wisdom of God revealed. Why has God set aside Israel? And we learned that God has only set them aside partially and temporarily. And we saw the wisdom of God in Romans 9, 10, and 11. In Romans 9, we saw Israel's election. In Romans 10, we saw Israel's rejection. And in Romans 11, we saw Israel's future restoration. It's kind of a parenthesis in the presentation of the gospel to ask the Jewish question. What about Israel? What about the Jews? What about the nation of Israel? And that God has still got a plan and a purpose for them and vindicating God's plan with them. And then the fourth and last division that we're in, and we're going to come to the conclusion of next Wednesday night, is exhortation, the will of God revealed, chapters 12 to 15. How should a saved man or woman live or walk? And the answer is in chapter 12, verse 2, by being transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and perfect and acceptable will of God. So we go from condemnation to salvation to exhortation, how we should live out this life as a new believer in Jesus Christ. And then chapter 16 is merely the conclusion. But Paul tonight is going to actually talk about his marvelous ministry and talk about the Romans. Now, an interesting shift when you go from the doctrinal section to the practical section. He goes from talking to them to talking about them. He's not talking to them about doctrinal issues anymore. He's talking to them as kind of a pastor, heart to heart. And he kind of wants them to understand that when he wrote to them, he wasn't looking down on them, thinking that, you know, they needed him to educate them, but that he wanted them to be reminded of the power of the gospel and that calling that we have to preach the gospel. I think one of the great needs in the church today is for us to know the gospel and for us to know there's power in the gospel. In chapter 1 of the book of Romans, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he gave us the reason why. He said, because it's the power of God unto salvation, to the Jew first and also to the Greek or to the Gentile. And even though I've preached the gospel these many years, I'm still convinced that God uses the preaching of his word to save souls. That God uses the gospel as it's preached to bring men and women to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. But let's look at the marks of Paul's ministry. And I want you to write them down if you're taking notes, and I'll try not to tarry too long on them. But the first is in verses 14 and 15, and that it was given to him by God's grace. Any ministry that we have or calling is given to us by God's grace. Any gifts that he gives us, any ministry that he gives us and entrusts to us is all given by the grace of God. Now, go back with me to verse 14, or go with me to verse 14 and 15, and let's read those verses. Paul says, and I myself also am persuaded of you. So Paul now is speaking personally to the Roman believers, my brethren, that you also are full of goodness and that you're filled with knowledge and that you're able to admonish one another. Nevertheless, brethren, I have written. So as I said, this is his reason for writing this letter. The more boldly unto you in some sort as putting you in mind because of, here it is, the grace that is given to me of God. I want you to know about the grace that is given to me of God. Now, Paul commended the church in Rome for three important qualities. And I think it's pretty cool that in verse 14, you see these qualities that someone called the checkoff points of a good church. And again, they are qualities that are there in a good, true church. Number one, he says you are full of goodness. And so he's commending them and kind of talking about them. You're full of goodness. Notice it there in verse 14. He says, I'm writing to you because I'm persuaded that you're full of goodness. Now, what does that mean? Well, it doesn't mean that they were sinless or that they were perfect. We know that no one is perfect, right? You go, well, I live with someone that thinks they're perfect. I know a guy that thinks he's perfect. No, not one. If we say that we've not sinned, then we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So he said, you're full of goodness. He didn't mean that they were perfectly righteous. We're righteous in our standing before God. But he's talking about their moral character, that they were in love with God, that they served God, that they were committed to God. So this full of goodness conveys this idea, moral goodness or excellence in their motives and in their lifestyle. In their motives and in their lifestyle. So when we serve the Lord, he's given us a ministry by grace. We want to be full of goodness. We want to do it with the right motives, and we want to do it right moral standards. So they strove to do what's right. They were motivated by a sense of goodness and a desire to be righteous before God. I think that's commendable. I think as Christians, we should want to live righteous lives. We should want to live good lives. We should want to live holy lives. If you're a child of God, you don't want to dishonor God. You don't want to stumble other people. You want to do what's right. So they were Christians that were committed. Let's live holy lives. Let's live good lives. Let's live lives that are morally reflective of the holiness of God. So it is evidence of true conversion It was evidence of the fruit of the Spirit. Check your own heart and ask yourself, am I committed to moral excellence? Am I committed to moral excellence when no one is looking? Only God. Am I concerned about what I watch on the computer, or I watch in television, or movies that I go to, or thoughts that I allow in my mind, or things that I say? Am I committed to living a pure and holy life? So he commended them for that. Second thing that he commended them for in verse 14 was that they were filled with knowledge. They were filled with knowledge. Now again, it doesn't mean they knew everything. And again, you know people who think they know everything. They weren't omniscient. Only God knows everything, but it meant that they had a sound, practical understanding of the Christian faith that issued in wholesome conduct. I want you to think about these first two qualities of this church. It's my prayer for Revival Christian Fellowship, that you be full of goodness and that you be filled with knowledge. And I believe that the goodness is the fruit of knowing God's word. And it was speaking about their practical understanding and grasp of the things of the Christian faith. You can't live the Christian faith if you don't know the Christian faith. God cannot sanctify your ignorance. You can't neglect your Bible and expect to be a victorious Christian. It just doesn't work that way. You have to give God that ammunition. Pour into your life the Word of God, and the Spirit of God takes that and transforms us into the image of Jesus Christ. And I think the great need in the church again today is not only a commitment to moral excellence, but a commitment to a knowledge and a study of the Word of God. Get involved in a FIT class or a foundations class or men's Bible study, or couples Bible study, or women's Bible study, and go deeper and get your Bible every day and study God's Word and get some good commentaries and Bible study tools and go on revival.tv and listen to the teaching and take notes and write down things and study the Word of God. And then notice the third quality in this beautiful church. They were able to admonish one another, verse 14. They were able to admonish one another. Now, that statement is pretty amazing. The Greek term translated admonish comes from two other words, one that means the mind, and the other which means to put something somewhere. And when these words are combined, they form the term admonish. The word admonish means the mind and to put something somewhere. So the word came to mean to teach someone by putting it in their mind or placing it before them. So he says, you are able to actually admonish each other. Now, the word able before the word admonish is where we get our word dunamis or power from. So they have the dunamis or the ability to place before one another in their minds the things of God. This is where Jay Adams got the title for his popular book, Competent to Counsel, because in some even modern translations, that's what that phrase actually, that's how they render that phrase. He says, I am sure that you are competent to counsel each other. I like that. What he's saying is, as a church, that you guys exhorted each other and taught one another, challenged one another, and spoke to one another, and you shared God's word with one another. You know, even when you come on Wednesday night, it's not all about just listening to me teach just one monologue up here. But after church is over, you can even, maybe something you heard stirred your heart and you know somebody needs to be encouraged and you share it with them. Or maybe God gave you a verse earlier today. You find somebody that God wants you to share with and you put it in their mind or you put it before them. You admonish them. And I believe that you're also able to counsel each other. I believe that if you've got the Holy Spirit and you know your Bible, you are competent to counsel. You go, well, don't I need a doctorate in theology or a PhD or something like that? Not really. You need the Holy Spirit and the knowledge of God's Word, and you need to surrender to God's Spirit, and God can give you that gift, that ability to admonish, to counsel, to teach other people. And every one of us need to be doing that. So we need to be committed to moral excellence, to a knowledge of God's Word, and to admonishing one another. Now, the problem in the church today is a lot of times people avoid confrontation altogether. No one likes confrontation. No one likes to admonish another person or tell them something from the Word or exhort them from the Word. And sometimes we not only avoid it, but we maybe go overboard and we face head on an issue with somebody, but we talk to them or admonish them in a prideful attitude. The Bible says if you admonish someone or you correct someone or you help someone, that you should do it in a spirit of meekness, considering yourself. That you should go humbly, not proudfully. You shouldn't be condemning them, but you should be in an admonition, just setting God's word lovingly before them. And we need to be willing to confront one another and challenge one another and admonish one another. If you have a Christian friend that maybe is slacking off in their commitment to God and to His word, maybe He wants you to admonish them. Not to gossip about them, not to backbite about them, but to admonish them, to actually go to them and say, look, I want to encourage you, man. I miss you on Wednesday night or Sunday, or why aren't you in the home Bible study anymore? Hey, you're still praying, you're reading your Bible. Don't forget God's word, and you're sharing scripture with them. That's what it means. You're admonishing one another. You're sharing. Remember Proverbs 27, verse 6 says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses of the enemy, right? Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses of an enemy. And this term is used as a comprehensive term for counseling or teaching or instructing someone else. So we need to be encouraged that we need to admonish one another. Now, two reasons, verse 15, Paul wrote to them. He wrote to them to remind them of some important truths, putting them in your mind. And then secondly, verse 15, because of God's grace calling him to minister to the Gentiles. Notice that verse 15, nevertheless, brethren, that I've written unto you more boldly unto you than some sort, as putting it in your mind. I want to, again, the idea of admonishing or placing it in your mind because of the grace it was given unto me of God. Because God's grace called him, he wanted to minister to them. You know, God saves us by his grace. God sanctifies us by his grace. And then we serve God by his grace. Romans 12, 6 says, having gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. He saves us. He sanctifies us, and we serve God, all based, verse 15, on the grace of God. Let me give you the second main point in Paul's ministry, and we won't go slow through the rest of these verses. Some of you are looking at this going, if he goes this slow the rest of the night, he either will not get done or we'll be here till midnight. Verse 16, this is the second point. It was centered in the gospel. It was centered in the gospel. It was given by God's grace, and it centers in the gospel. Verse 16. He says that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. This very Jewish rabbi, Saul of Tarsus, converted on the road to Damascus, called by God to be the apostle to the Gentiles. Ministering the gospel of God, there it is, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. So Paul tells us that his focus in his ministry was the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, the word Paul used for minister, we get our word liturgy from it. It was used in the New Testament exclusively for religious and ritualistic service. So Paul is picturing his ministry as a priestly ministry. Not that it was sacramental, Jesus already died on the cross, but that those who he won to Christ through the preaching of the gospel were offered to Christ as a sacrifice. What a cool thought. You know, everything we do in our ministry is to be an act of worship. Everything we do, all of the ministry God has entrusted to us is to be an act of worship to God. So his preaching of the gospel was like a priestly ministry, and the Gentiles' conversion and ministry to them was like offering up a sacrifice unto God. So Paul was preaching the gospel. Ministers, I believe, are called to preach and to proclaim and to herald the gospel. When Paul told Timothy to preach the word, he used the word keruso for the word preach. You know what that word keruso means? It means to herald. It means to proclaim. He didn't say just get up and give a little rap or a talk or a little kind of speech. He said proclaim something. The gospel is good news. It's not good views. You should write that down. That's a pretty profound little statement. You're kind of looking at me like, I'm thinking, write it down. Don't just stare at me. And it's not original, by the way. Nothing's original that I say. People go, wow, Pastor John, where do you get that? Commentaries and other preachers. And I've quoted other guys for so long, now I think it's all mine. So I've forgotten everything. But the gospel is not good views. It's good news. And I pray that as long as God enables me to preach, I never tire and never vary and never veer from preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's all I want to preach. I want to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. That God gave his son to die for our sins according to the scriptures. That he rose again from the dead according to the scriptures. And that faith in Jesus Christ saves us. We're saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Amen? It's on Christ the solid rock we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. You know, when somebody's drowning, they need to be saved. And the world is drowning in their sin. And we need to throw them the lifesaver of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. He didn't come just to reform man, just to patch up man, just to educate man, just to make man religious. He came to redeem us, to save us from our sins. And so it means that we need to preach the gospel. I think you need to preach the gospel. You need to know the gospel and to preach the gospel. The gospel, the whole gospel, and nothing but the gospel. It's the whole church's job to preach the whole gospel to the whole world. It's the greatest need in the world today. I thank God for the ministry of Billy Graham. And one of the keynotes of his ministry was always the preaching of the gospel. He never wavered. He never veered. And we see that through that man, the power of the gospel to change lives. We need to take as many people to heaven with us as we can. We all need to be gospel preachers. And his preaching was also not only centered in the gospel, but it was an offering up of the Gentiles to God, an acceptable sacrifice to God. The Gentiles, like an acceptable sacrifice to God. Now, the Jews rejected the Gentiles, said they couldn't be saved, but God accepted the Gentiles. I want you to notice the third characteristic of Paul's ministry, and should be of ours as well. It was all done for the glory of God. It was all done for the glory of God. It was given by the grace of God. It centered in the gospel of God, and it was all done for the glory of God. Verse 17 and 18, he says, I have therefore whereof I may glory. There's a basis in my ministry for glory, but it's through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. Paul's not going to glory in his intellect. Paul's not going to glory in his programs. Paul's not going to glory in his achievements. He's going to glory in God and in the gospel and in Jesus Christ. Because I have a basis to glory, but not in myself, in those things that pertain to God. And notice verse 18. For I will not dare speak of any of those things which Christ has wrought by me to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed. I love this man, Paul the Apostle. I can't wait to meet him in heaven. May his tribe increase. May God give us more Paul the Apostles. Paul said, all I did was for the glory of God. It was given by God's grace. It was centered in the gospel, and it was for God's glory. Paul's glory or boasting was not in his own person, verse 17, but in Jesus Christ. And in verse 18, he knew that it was Christ who was working through him. You know that Paul was a great intellect? The story is told that Gamaliel, the great Jewish rabbi, couldn't keep Paul in books, that he was so hungry for books. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel, the greatest teacher of that time. And Gamaliel said, I couldn't keep him in books. He just devoured them all. And Paul had a great intellect. He was highly educated. He could speak with the Athenians and the Stoics and all the Greek philosophers on Mars Hill, and he could contend with them, and he could talk to any of the Jewish leaders and contend with them. But Paul was a humble man. And I do believe that one of, if not the most important quality in being used by God, is a genuine, authentic humility. Paul understood the idea that John the Baptist, when he said, I must decrease, so he must increase. When Paul realized, John the Baptist just said, I'm just a voice of one crying in the wilderness. I believe that Paul the Apostle was completely humbled by God's grace. And that's the response. When you realize that you're the recipient of God's grace, that there is absolutely no reason why God should save you, and let alone why God should use you, and yet you give yourself without reservation, 100%, to God, and you say, God, here am I, use me. God will use you in a marvelous, wonderful way. I believe that with all my heart. Now, he may not use you the way you desire to be used, but that's the whole idea. You come to him without any goals or plans or ambitions, and you humbly just say, Lord, here am I, send me. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll be what you want me to be. I'll do whatever it is you want me to do. Have your way in me. God uses the foolish things, the weak things, the base things, the despised things. The things which are not, to bring to naught the things that are. I believe with all my heart, the men and women that God has most mightily used are men and women who walk humbly with their God. The minute you begin to think you're hot stuff or you got something to offer, God, aren't you glad to have me on your team? Like God gets all excited when you dedicate your life to him. Woo-hoo! We're really going to rock and roll now. Like God got something kind of a real wing-ding deal when you joined his club. No, that God would use us should humble us, and then we should be at his disposal. And Paul was humble, and he realized that it was all for God's glory. All ministry is to be to the praise and the honor and the glory of God. Grace leads to glory. The purpose of ministry is the glory of God. Galatians 6:4. Paul said, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I am crucified unto the world. I love that. I am dead to the world and the world is dead to me. And I just want to live for God and be used by God. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 6, when Paul was instructing Timothy about men who should be in the ministry of the church, one of the qualifications is not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil, which was, God, devil was condemned because of his pride. And that word there in the Greek, not a novice, means not newly planted, not a new convert. Give them time to grow and get strong and then begin to bear fruit. And less because if a new convert begins to be in the ministry as a pastor, they can be lifted up with pride and they can fall into the condemnation of the devil. So ask yourself, do you understand that God has given you a grace gift? Do you understand that your calling as a minister of Jesus Christ is to just get the gospel out, pray for it, give for it, serve for it, work alongside others, team with others, get the gospel out, share the gospel? Do you understand that all ministry is for the glory of God, not for the glory of man? Let me give you number 4, verse 19. It's to be done through God's power. All ministry is to be done in the power of God, not our own resources or strength. Notice verse 19. He says, through mighty signs, and he's talking about how God had used him to make the Gentiles obedient in deed and word. And part of that was not only preaching the gospel, but God was working through Paul's preaching and confirming the word preached with signs and wonders. Now, it always came in this order. The word was preached, and then it was confirmed with the miracles. The miracles don't come first. The word comes, and the miracles follow to confirm. And believers should never follow miracles. Miracles should follow believers. That's another good thing to write down. It's not original, but it's important. Believers shouldn't be following after miracles. Miracles should be naturally following believers. But notice in verse 19, he says, they're through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, which is actually West Macedonia, the northwestern area of Greece, he says, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. And there's a repetition again. You might say that's the theme of the book of Romans. The gospel, the good news of Christ. Now, Paul's ministry and Christ's ministry through Paul was by the power of signs and wonders. Now, those two terms, I want you to understand them. They both comprise what we would call miracles. But actually, a miracle would do two things. It would be a sign pointing, giving us the significance, and the wonder was the effect that the miracle had on those who saw the sign or the miracle. You know, when you see a sign, it's there to tell you something, right? It's there to tell you turn right, turn left, dead end, speed limit, stop, you know, bridge out or whatever. Signs are there to communicate something. So this term was used for miracles because the miracles pointed to something. What did they point to? They pointed that Jesus Christ was Lord. They pointed that the gospel that the apostles preached was true. But I don't believe that anyone's faith should be built on a miracle. It needs to be built on the word, hearing the word of God and faith in Jesus Christ. If you come to believe in Jesus Christ because someone you know was healed, what are you going to do when they get sick again? Well, what are you going to do if the healing doesn't last and they die? Oh, well, I thought God was going to heal them. I thought God was real. Can God do miracles? Yes. But that's not the number one thing he's doing today. If miracles follow believers, great. I'm all for that. But if believers are following after miracles, that's a very dangerous thing. And what often happens because we so crave for the experiential, we so crave for the power, and we so crave for a visible manifestation of God that we want to see, you know, someone healed or cancer healed or, you know, someone with a missing limb get an arm, which is funny. A lot of these miracle meetings say, you know, it's not very rarely someone's in with no arms and goes out with two arms, you know. I mean, really clearly confirmed that God raised them, or all this idea that God raised people from the dead. Can God raise somebody from the dead? Yeah, he can raise somebody from the dead, but I don't think that that's mainly what he's doing today. I would never say God can't do it and God doesn't do it, but the propensity, the tendency, is for us to gravitate toward that, and we forget the gospel and we forget the word. You say, well, can't you do a miracle and then people come running and then you preach the gospel? Yeah, that's true. But you better make sure you preach the gospel and you point them to Jesus Christ. And they come under a sense of their sinfulness and need to repent and believe in Jesus. Paul and Silas performed a miracle and the people came running out of the city and thought they were pagan gods. And they didn't really immediately respond to the gospel. So, but Paul had these signs and wonders. And by the way, that was one of the indications of a true apostle. A true apostle, number one, had to be with Jesus from the beginning of his ministry, seen Jesus resurrected, and have miracles and signs and wonders as the evidence that his preaching was, or that he was an apostle. In chapter 2 Corinthians 12, verse 12, it says that very clearly, that this is the sign of a true apostle. So, the power, the dunamis of God. Every conversion is a power encounter which a spirit brings about regeneration in the life of a lost soul. So we see in verse 19 the scope of Paul's ministry, the power of Paul's ministry, and the nature of Paul's ministry, preaching the gospel and signs and wonders following. Now, I believe God heals, and I believe God has healed and does heal, but I believe the greatest miracle that we could ever witness is the transformation of a person's life. That God can take someone who is hardened in sin and change them into a child of God. Let me give you the fourth and last character of Paul's ministry, and should be ours as well. It was according to God's plan. So he was doing the work of God the way God wanted to do in the purpose and the plan of God, verse 20 and 21. He says, yes, so I have strived to preach the gospel. Paul can't get away from the gospel, the good news. Not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. Verse 21, as it is written. Now, whenever you find that as it is written, of course, he's quoting from the Old Testament. And in this situation, he's quoting from Isaiah 52, verse 15. But as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see. And they that have not heard shall understand. The context of Isaiah, he's talking about the suffering Messiah, and that the Gentiles who sit in darkness would see a great light. And then he goes into Isaiah 53, but they've not believed our report. To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? So Paul is actually saying that his calling as an apostle to the Gentiles was in the purpose and plan and design of God. Let me tell you about what you want in your ministry. What you want in your ministry is to be doing the will of God. You want to be doing what God wants you to do, where God wants you to do it, and how God wants you to do it. You say, well, how do I know that I'm doing it in the will of God? Present your body as a living sacrifice. Don't give God any stipulations. Don't give God any terms. Don't say, God, I'll live for you if it's in Hawaii. You want me to call me to be a missionary, God? Okay. Calvary Chapel, Lahaina, Maui. I sense the Spirit calling right now. And the Lord says, go ye northward to Barstow. You go, never mind, God. I'm just going to go back and, you know, work in the office. God might call you to a place that you may not want to go, but let me tell you something. He never makes you go against your will, but he'll make you willing to go. Amen? He'll make you willing to go. The Bible says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he'll give you what? The desires of your heart. See, if you're truly delighting yourself in the Lord, then your desires are going to be, I'll go where you want me to go, I'll do what you want me to do, I'll be what you want me to be, and I'll say whatever it is you want me to say. Lord, you want me to go to Barstow? I'm ready to go to Barstow. I hope it's Maui, but I'll go to Barstow. Wherever you want me to go. Because the Lord is your delight. You know you're going to be with him. You're going to be in His will. You're going to be doing His work. And that's where the joy lies. The joy lies when you're in the will of God, doing the work of God for the glory of God. And Paul says, I strove to preach the gospel where Christ was not named. And this wasn't because he wanted to avoid rivalry with other ministers. It was because Paul had a passion for the lost. Everybody wants to start a church where churches flourish. Why don't you go where there's no church, where people need to hear about Jesus? I remember the first time I went to China, and we were passing out Chinese, Cantonese New Testaments in the city of Canton. And we found college students that could speak English. And these kids were 20, 25 years old, and they'd never heard about Jesus Christ. They never even heard about Christianity. And they were just soaking up the gospel as we preached with them. I think, well, why not go to China with the gospel? Why not go to places where the word is not heard? Why not go where the church is not planted? Why not reach out? If you really have a burden for the lost, go where there's lost people. Ask God to send you there. Ask God to give you a burden for people that are lost. I've had Christians say, man, I'm so bummed out. My job, I'm the only Christian there. I work in this office just full of heathens. Can I have a job at Revival? I want to work with saints. And that's where they need the gospel. That's where the light shines brightest in the darkest places, amen? Your office is your mission field. Your job is your mission field. And Paul says, look, I've striven to preach the gospel where Christ is not named. Just as he was called, verse 21, to preach the gospel to those who had not seen and those who have not heard, they shall understand. Now, let me just review this real quick, these five aspects of ministry. First of all, it's given to us by the grace of God. Secondly, it's centered in the gospel of God. Thirdly, it's done for the glory of God. And fourthly, it's done in God's power, relying upon the Holy Spirit. And fifthly and lastly, it's done according to God's plan. May God use us as His ministers. Amen. Let's pray.